Meet Henry Molaison. He had a major part of his brain removed. Why in the world would you do that, you may wonder? Well, let's rewind to Manchester, Connecticut in 1933. Picture a young Henry, just 7 years old, innocently playing in a typical American neighborhood when, bam, he's struck down by a neighbor on a bike, hitting his head hard. 3 years later, Henry starts having epileptic seizures, intensifying over time. Unable to bear the pain, Henry opts for a radical solution. In 1953, at the age of 27, Henry goes under the knife. Neurosurgeon William Scoville removes his hippocampus and all surrounding tissues. You gotta be kidding me, this is outrageous, you might say. And you'd be right. It's hard to imagine that during our grandparents' time, lobotomy was a standard treatment for various neurological and mental disorders. Today we'd call that barbaric, not to say useless. Yet that was the medical reality not so long ago. They used to blow tobacco smoke up people's asses to revive drowning victims or use mercury to treat syphilis. Even Pepsi was once sold as medicine. Today these treatments would surely not be that popular. So what became of Henry? It's a story of bittersweet outcomes. On one hand, the seizures stopped and Henry kept his personality. He was self-aware and his behavior didn't change. But on the flip side, for the next 55 years, right up until his death at the age of 82, Henry couldn't hold on to new memories for more than a few seconds. Innovations like cell phones, DVD players, or Apple itself might as well have not existed for him. But here's the silver lining. Thanks to Henry's ordeal and those old-school harsh treatments, we've gained invaluable insights into how memory is actually formed in our brains. In this video, we will explore how our brains handle memories, along with the neurobiologist's book, Remember, The Science of Memory and the Art of Forgetting. Let's break down the basics of how we remember. Memory formation happens in four main stages. First up, encoding, or as I like to call it, translating everything into your brain's language. Take yourself as an example, now probably chilling on your couch, sipping tea, eating snacks, surrounded by different aromas and sounds, including my voice. All this sensory input needs to be translated into a format that your nervous system can understand. Exactly, it's similar to how coders type what might look kinda gibberish into their computers and voila, it turns into a user-friendly interface. It's the same with colors to designers. Each shade has its own specific hex code. Then when your brain takes all these separate bits of information that came in through different senses, the second stage, consolidation, starts. That's when the brain starts to weave all these separate bits into one big picture. But how does a bunch of scattered neural activities fuse into a connected network that we recognize as a memory? Well, we're still at the stage of who the hell knows how, but at least we've got a decent idea of the place in the brain where this magic happens. Now, and you've probably heard of this place, let's talk about the hippocampus. Nestled at the center of the brain, the hippocampus is crucial for memory consolidation. Its name is derived from this Greek word meaning seahorse. Some say it does resemble the fish, and some could say a lot. Whether you see the resemblance or not, this brain region is the master weaver of our memories, Madame Webb, processing the who, what, where, when, and why of our experiences. So the hippocampus stitches all these bits of info from different brain areas into a cohesive block, a solid neural network, so that it can be accessed later. And if this network gets a ping, boom, you're reliving a memory. And I just fast-forwarded to the fourth stage, retrieval. If a person's hippocampus is damaged, they cannot perform the second stage, to pack the encoded information to pass it to the third stage, storage, and therefore the fourth stage cannot occur because there's nothing to retrieve. This is why Henry Mollison, despite having a functional brain in many other respects, could not form new memories. His brain looked like this, while it was supposed to function like this. For Henry, new people remained strangers forever. He couldn't retain new vocabulary, new songs, the plot of a movie, or what happened yesterday. But he didn't lose his memory for everything. For example, he could repeat a phone number or a short list back to his doctor. Of course, a minute later, he would have completely forgotten both the phone number and that he'd ever had a conversation with his doctor about this. But he could hold 10 numbers in his brain for at least a few seconds. Hold on. If the hippocampus processes all the incoming information, how could Henry remember anything at all? And that brings us to another million-dollar question. Where exactly is memory stored? While it's true that the hippocampus plays a key role in connecting and transferring newly encoded information to our long-term memory, this memory storage isn't one specific spot. It's decentralized and spread throughout the entire brain. You're probably familiar with the idea that the visual cortex, situated in the occipital lobe, processes everything we see. Then there's the auditory cortex for sounds, the olfactory cortex for smells, and even the somatosensory cortex that tackles sensations like pain, temperature, and touch. Unlike a singular storage unit, memory is scattered across various brain regions, stored as patterns of neural activity in the exact regions that initially processed the incoming data. Picture this: someone's in a scanner, tasked with remembering a specific event. Researchers can literally watch as the individual's brain searches through memory. At first, there's observable neural activity across the entire brain. As the brain's current activity syncs up with the neural patterns from the initial encoding, things stabilize, and that's when they hit the jackpot and declare, "Now I remember." Let's say I ask you to remember Spider-Man. It's as if your brain pulls up a file with an image of him. At that moment, the same parts of your visual cortex that would light up if you were actually looking at Spider-Man become active. If I were to ask, "Did you see Spider-Man?" deep down a part of you would respond, "Yeah, I did." This means that when you're retrieving a visual memory, your brain acts as though the image is right in front of your eyes. To recall an experience or piece of knowledge, your brain essentially reactivates the sensory areas that initially processed it. And here's the fascinating takeaway. To our brains, there's virtually no distinction between experiencing something in reality or recalling it from memory. Whether it's a smell, a visual image, or a feeling, if it's happening in your memory, to your brain, it's happening in real life. You might still be wondering, if our long-term memory is processed by the hippocampus and stored across the brain, then why and how did Henry manage to remember anything at all, even for just a few seconds before he forgot? This is a crucial question. The case of Henry Mollison totally transformed what we thought we knew about the brain. It highlighted the differences between two types of memory, long-term and short-term. With Henry's hippocampus out of the picture, it was clear that the answers had to be found elsewhere in the brain. It was only later that the world caught on to the role of the prefrontal cortex, which manages and stores the events unfolding in the present moment. You understood that last sentence, right? That's your working memory in action, facilitated by your prefrontal cortex. It grabs the start of a sentence and holds on all the way to the end, helping you make sense of it all. There, I just dropped a full stop. And now you've got an idea of what the prefrontal cortex and working memory are for. This type of memory is what lets us keep a phone number in mind just long enough to save it or remember a Wi-Fi password our buddy just shared. And yes, even Henry could hold on to something like the modern Apple logo, but only for a brief window, about 15 to 30 seconds before his working memory got wiped clean again. Psychologists break it down further. Visual information sticks in what's called a visuospatial sketchpad, while sounds loop around in a phonological loop, constantly repeating words and tunes, words and tunes. Way back in 1956, George Miller managed to put a number on our working memory's capacity. 7 plus or minus 2 items. That means we're good at juggling between 5 and 9 items at a time. Try to remember a string of 11 digits on the fly and you'll probably feel challenged. However, knowing how working memory functions can help you better equip your brain to tackle information. Look closely at the screen and try to memorize the entire sequence of numbers. Now, what do you remember? Surely some of you nailed a sequence of 5 or even 7 digits, but how? Most likely you broke it down into smaller blocks, making the initial flood of numbers more manageable. 331, 726, 194, 82. Why the heck do I need to remember it anyway? Well, this is just a basic example to illustrate a point. Let's connect this to something more real life. When you dive into a new topic, don't try to absorb every detail, all the causes and effects in one go. Start with one piece, get a solid grasp on it, then move on to the next, and then the next. Eventually, you'll begin to see how everything connects. This is how I write scripts. Often the initial theme feels like a bunch of random numbers, but when you break them down into digestible blocks and take time to understand each one of them, that's when the magic happens. You start seeing the connections. And if you're lucky, it suddenly clicks. Hey, this isn't just a bunch of numbers, it's actually a phone number. See the difference between these two sequences of digits? The second sequence isn't just broken into blocks. We see that it's a phone number, making it way easier to grasp. That's because in the second scenario, you've not only found a structure, you've also found meaning. We rarely stop to think about why we have a harder time remembering random numbers compared to a structured phone number. It seems obvious. The first sequence lacks meaning and structure, unlike the second one, which can help us find meaning due to its structure. But what if the number is given to you by someone you're fond of? Remember how your heart races and your palms sweat? How vividly do you remember the entire scene? This can make even a phone number stick in the memory more effectively. This leads to a key finding. Information in working memory doesn't start to solidify in the hippocampus unless we pay attention to it. In other words, if the information doesn't resonate with us personally, it'll vanish from our temporary storage within 30 seconds, making room for new data. Paying attention requires conscious effort. Your default brain activity is not attentive. Your inattentive brain is zoned out, daydreaming on autopilot and full of constant background repetitive thinking. You can't create a new memory in this state. If you want to remember something, you have to turn your brain on, wake up, become consciously aware, and pay attention. I mentioned earlier that we consolidate all incoming information, right? Well, I left out a crucial piece: emotions. Our brains record the emotions and feelings we experience along with the events, and when triggered by a photo, a scent, or a song, we can momentarily not just recall but relive or rehear the moments that left a great emotional mark on us. Ready to put your memory to the test? As this video wraps up, I'm going to ask you a few questions. After each one, pause the video and see if you can answer. Which part of the brain was removed from Henry Mollison? How many stages are there in memory formation? What are these four stages? How long does working memory retain information? What is essential for memory consolidation and storage to occur? You might find your answers are a bit vague. Maybe you've forgotten some details, skipped a stage, or mixed up terms. That's normal. And by the way, did you notice the incorrect Apple logos we slipped in three times? Here, here, and here. Especially if you were snacking while watching, it's understandable. This video is just one of thousands in your feed. Once you click away, you'll probably forget about it in 30 seconds. And that's okay. Instead, try to think about how this applies to you. Try to focus more on engaging your emotions and finding meaning to build new, long-lasting memories. Emotions don't just get recorded, they also sharpen our focus, kickstarting the memory consolidation process. Significant facts and events weave together to create the story of your life. Making a memory literally changes your brain. Every memory you have is a result of a lasting physical alteration in your brain in response to what you experienced. You went from not knowing something to knowing something, from never before having experienced a day to having lived another day. And to be able to remember tomorrow what happened today means that your brain has to change. If you stop forming new memories for whatever reason, you risk ending up like Henry Mollison after his surgery. You know who to share this video with. We say a big thank you for all the supporters from our Patreon. And I'm the researcher.